So hi Tushaj, welcome to the interview of CA Monk. So today we'll be interviewing Tushaj, who is a forensic auditor working with one of the reputed firm. So Tushaj, first of all, very basic question: what is forensic audit? Who should go for forensic audit? And matlab, what makes a forensic audit so a boom word in this coming days?
Yeah, hi Shivam. I'm glad to share my experience with you, and let's start with the question. So what you told, what is forensic audit? So forensic basically in terms, in basic literal terms means whatever can be used as an evidence in a court. So basically forensic, when you see in criminal side, so there also there is this forensic lab which give you reports. So from accounting side, what happens in forensic? And they never happened, or a corporate scandal has happened, and they need lawyers, obviously. But lawyers are not that good with accounting to understand what has actually happened. So that's where basically forensic term, forensic accounting, or forensic investigation terms come in, where the companies or either the lawyers, they hire the services of forensic accountants to kind of help them get in comfort on what has actually happened, because forensic accountants basically don't give a conclusion as to the fraud has happened or not. They give a fact whether what has actually happened, and basis that the jury decides or the court decides that whether a fraud has happened or not. Yeah. So basically forensic investigation includes helping your client find the facts of what has been alleged to prove or disprove that.
Okay. Okay. So when I see a forensic audit, I usually remember one case of CID. In which a Sanukya goes to some forensic lab and that stuff. So is it, matlab, is it just a theoretical, matlab, or is it something related to the real life also? In terms
so,
of-
like what you see, I completely recall what you said in CID. What happens is, when a case comes in, it usually goes to the forensic lab, and from there certain reports come in which help them with the investigation.
Correct.
So basically in a similar way, forensic investigation, the same thing happens. If I can give you an example, what happens is, say there is a fraud happening in a company, and an employee has done a procurement fraud. Basically, procurement fraud involves a kickbacks getting from vendors to give them more business for their company, right? Okay. So in that, if we want to prove, for example, if the company has received an allegation, so if company wants to investigate and prove whether that allegation is true or incorrect, okay, then they need evidence. Now, how is evidence gathered is, when I talk about forensic accounting or forensic investigation in that terms, basically it is ledgers and all those, but along with that, you need digital evidence. So there, for court purposes, if you want to go to the court, you need to maintain the integrity of the data that has been copied. And plus you need to go through the communications which that employee had, might have had with the, say, external vendor or internal teams, that who all are involved, how was the, what was the modus operandi, and what is the amount of fraud involved. So in that, we use digital forensic tools on their system to get the data from their server, investigate all those things, corroborate with the evidence that we found in the accounting errors as well. And okay, as a and in the report, it is present as a fact which lawyers or the company themselves can use to incriminate the employee. So this is on a short level. The same thing happens for huge corporate scandals that, such as financial statement frauds.
Okay. So, matlab, is this a difference? Matlab, what creates a difference between a normal audit and a forensic audit in terms of research work, or in terms of a person being skeptical, or matlab, what makes it different from other things, and what gives this as a leverage, or a, matlab, nowadays everyone wants to say that ki, agar koi fraud hua, toh we'll go for forensic audit. Agar kuch ho raha hai, toh we'll go for a forensic audit. So what is this, matlab, what is that thing which is making the movement towards a forensic audit in a faster manner?
So in the current environment, what is happening is the regulatory framework has changed a lot in our Indian economy. We are kind of gearing up with what the, say, developed countries have already been there. So recently, due to that, what has happened is, and plus there has been a lot of funding in that has been coming in from private equity as well as the government companies, the loans had increased in past few years. So due to that, what happened is certain businesses were prone to like misutilizing these funds. That is the reason during these times, the scope of forensic has increased. And coming to your first question, that what is something special about forensic, which is over and above, say, you say external audit or internal audit. External audit or external audit is an annual review basically.
Okay.
So it is an annual assurance which you give basically that whether the statements or financials that are showing up, whether those are true and fair, show the company's correct picture or not. While internal audit is basically aimed at improving company's operational efficiency and closing the control gaps. Now, when I say forensic is where the internal audit stops. Basically, internal audit stops at a point, and after that, what happens is basically that covers forensic audit. So in forensic audit, there is always a specific special mandate in the scope of work. For example, it will tell you what. So forensic audit basically comes into two types. Now, since you have bifurcated into this external and internal and forensic, other than that, forensic audit basically forms into two types. One is reactive and one is proactive. Proactive is kind of consultancy services, which you can compare with internal audit. What internal audit does, but forensic audit does it a step further from a fraud perspective. And reactive is whenever a fraud has happened, then again that perspective comes in that company would need something to incriminate or they want to kind of quantify the losses that has happened because of such a fraud. So in those cases, they would need services of a forensic accountant instead of hiring an external auditor or an internal auditor. Because forensic, when you do these investigations, you need these tools and technologies of forensic, which are especially called fall in the domain of digital forensics and experience.
Okay. So can you just give one example in of your life experience till now? Ki, what was the best case you did? In terms of ki, this also we can do in matlab, this is how we do a forensic audit in terms of ki, how you investigated the thing, what make this a trigger point, how you find out the fraud and stuff. Matlab, just a small example or anything.
Yeah, a small and simple example that most of the companies that do is, I will discuss about this, is a kind of a fraud which happens from the funding that company has got from the borrowers basically. This could be from private equity as well.
Okay.
So basically what happens is when companies get funding, say when it's a short-term funding, those are for your short-term purposes, for example, your cash credit. So you use it for your purchase of goods to maintain your business. It is basically a buffer for your working capital, which has to be used, right? Mm-hmm. So what companies do, what I have found out is when there is an LCV as well along with CC. So what happens is, when you purchase a good, for example, company A purchases goods from B, and to B it provides a LC. So bank gives an assurance on behalf of me that if I don't pay, a bank will pay to them, right? Okay. And the other party has the option to get that invoice which he has to discount to get it discounted so that he can get instant money, right? So what will happen is, say I will purchase from one party, right? That bill gets discounted. Once that bill gets discounted, now that money has gone to my vendor who had discounted that bill with his bank. My bank has provided that guarantee and that money has gone to that vendor. Now when I say C party, third party, now I will create a fake customer in my books of accounts, which is C. That is actually non-existent. And I will provide a sales invoice to them. So when I provide a sales invoice, basically a receivable is created in my books and I am supposed to receive money from them. So while it is a fake invoice, there actually is no money generation. But then too, if I want to get the funding of my own LC facility, what I'll do is I will tell my vendor that you pay to my customer will pay that money to me.
Okay.
So basically what happens in my books of accounts is I purchase goods. LC was discounted by my vendor. My vendor paid to that third customer, which two are interconnected, and that customer pays it to me.
Okay.
Back to me. So basically, my LC facility money, I am using it myself.
Correct.
This can be further done into, like, if your LC has to be paid in 180 days and say there is an interest of 6% that you have to pay. And if there is an FD or mutual fund scheme which is giving you 7% interest.
Okay.
You can kind of only rotate money. This is told a complete circular trading.
Okay.
Right? So here you can earn the interest differential as well. That's what many companies have done.
Achha. So how do you identify such kinds of frauds? Matlab, are you using some tools or is there some courses or is there, how you came to know about this fraud, or is it from the experience which over a period you get it, or is it the seniors which help you out to find out this, or suppose if I enter in this domain, so how I should think, how I should be able to find out the fraud the way you did?
Experience definitely helps, but see, there are some certain tests basically which we kind of run on your on your books of accounts, okay, as well as analysis of your bank statements.
Okay.
So basis those tests, you will be, so you could say, you could identify, first you would need, like here the first thing would be to identification whether the sales is fake or not. Okay. Right. So for identification of fake sales, I'm just giving you an example. You'll go and check the customer master, whether the customer master details have been captured properly or not. Usually in good organizations, it is a practice to capture customer master details properly. The invoice is supported or substantiated by proof of delivery of goods, whether the goods have actually moved. Basically, these kind of frauds can more happen in services, because in services, the proof, it is difficult to generate a proof. So when we ask for proof, client can have a reason. But there you can substantiate with the work papers as well as the reports if the client, if that our customer might have, right? So in that way, we identify whether the customer is usually fake or not, right? This is just kind of one step, but the main step comes in where you analyze the bank statement or bank accounts, where you would basically do a money trail of funds you will identify. Okay. Basically, when you are when we accounting, when we learn basic accounting, we used to see that when we book an expense, it is booked in an expense, then it is transferred to P&L, and ultimately P&L goes to balance sheet. Correct. Similarly, when a money is being paid to someone, then I need to identify where the money from there is going around. Okay. So what happens here is I might not have access to the third party account, but say I have five related parties. What I will see is I have purchased goods from one of my related parties. Okay. Now that related party has received a payment, has discounted that LC of on the same day. Mm-hmm. And around the same day or within 2 days, my other related party to whom I have sold goods,
okay,
is paying me round about the same amount.
Mm-hmm.
So this is kind of a round tripping where I'm using my own existing related parties to do that. Okay. But this is just an example. What happens is these guys have also become smart. They don't use related parties. They would usually use connected parties per se.
Okay.
Connected parties are indirectly related, and for that, further, from forensic analysis, you do some market intelligence research and all those things to establish whether there are any connections from your existing vendors or customers. Again, through your review of their master or customer master.
Okay. And after, if I look in this perspective, say after the COVID effect, so now everyone is moving towards this online work and the cyber related and this. So how do you see this cyber fraud growing and the scope of forensic audit growing, and in terms of job per se also, I think the forensic audit will be in a boom in the coming year, and everyone will be moving towards a forensic audit. So is it true, or how do you see this?
Yeah, so basically fraud theory entails that there is a fraud triangle. Whenever a fraud happens, a person does or a corporate does, there is usually opportunity, pressure and rationalization. Right, so when a time of crisis comes, like this is a breeding environment for fraud, you could say. That's and it involves personal fraud as well as corporate frauds. But what happens is what surfaces first are the personal frauds, which you refer to like cyber attacks, which usually include spamming, phishing and all those. Now, along with these, what happens is organizations are at a big risk considering cyber security. Because everyone is working from home, one thing, they are not working over their VPN, many of the organizations, nor do they have good implemented controls. So the organizational data is at the highest risk during these times when their computers are being connected to external networks. So these are the times from cyber perspective, it is the most riskiest. Even ACFA, that is the world's largest, they have also said like these are the times when the percentage or likelihood of frauds are maximum. Okay. And even when you look into large frauds that had happened earlier, like say Enron or
Jet Airways,
it usually follows there is a crisis after which the fraud surfaces. So even organizations during these times are kind of enticed to do fraud, because they, what would happen is this year they would know they wouldn't perform better, but they are in need of funding.
Correct.
So there would be a lot of accounting and continued accounting entries that would be formed to kind of show your books properly so that you can get funding easily.
Okay.
So in future, currently there might not be seen much frauds, But in future, I can kind of say there is going to be a lot of frauds happening and opportunities coming up.
Okay, so
especially it is the COVID.
It is like a chandi aa gayi aapke sector mein.
Yeah, for now. Like, but it is like there is calm before the storm, right? So okay. Currently, there would be like if we don't have many frauds coming up, there is a calm and a storm is coming after a year. When everything settles down, everything will start popping up.
Correct. So, I like the concept of forensic audit. So now, if suppose wants to get into this domain in terms of forensic audit, suppose if I want to get into this domain, okay. So what are the prerequisites you see as a interviewee in terms of key? This all qualities I want when a person is joining a forensic audit, or this is what I need in a forensic audit, or this type of mindset or the thinking approach which you would look into when you're selecting anyone. So what is your thought on this?
Yeah, correct. So usually people have that misconception that experience is very much necessary before joining forensics. Yes, to an extent, it is definitely necessary. It is an advantage if you have an experience, but it is not necessary that everyone gets a chance in articleship. Sorry, to learn or get some experience in forensics. So that is one thing. If experience is there, that is always preferable. Along with that, if you have a credential, like you have done a small certificate course or you have done, say, CFE, that is always an added advantage. But the main thing that I would like to stress on is what the interviewer looks upon is the mindset of the interviewee, okay. Right? For example, if he'll give a circumstance, and in that circumstance, how you would react, or how would you, as a forensic investigator, how would you investigate, or what would you think, or what would pop up in your mind? So, okay. Basis that he can judge that whether the mindset is forensic or not. See, okay. What happens is frauds are always one step ahead. They always know better. So, if you want to be a forensic accountant, you need to think like a fraudster. But do not do fraud. You need to think like a fraudster to protect the organization from doing fraud. That's how you can step up your game, because fraudsters are always one step ahead.
Correct. So, matlab, you need to be so smart that you are able to identify the fraud, and it's like you will get a more of a case studies in terms of a fraud per se when you're going for an interview, correct? No?
Yeah, correct. You will get a case study for that. The interview's first response should be that if I will do this fraud, then how would I do that? Obviously, we will not say that to the interviewer, correct. But he will say that I know this is how the fraudster might have done the fraud, and this is how it could be have been identified, or this is how it could have been mitigated.
Okay.
In the mind, it should come like, how will I do the same thing if I want to do that?
Okay. And what would be your advice for the CA freshers or the fresh chartered accountants who are coming into this domain for a forensic audit, whether they should go, whether they should not go, how they should consider this an opportunity? Because in the coming time, you said that it is going to be a boom sector per se. And what would be your party piece of advice for the CAs who are going to come in this sector?
For the new aspirants, I would say, first thing, if you are into forensics, then if you are interested into forensics, and why you are interested into forensics is basically everyone gets kind of, it becomes monotonous, the external audit routine or the internal audit routine. In forensic audit, what happens is every case is new, every kind of fraud is new, although they are divided into broad sub-categories, but every kind of the modus operandi is new. So the same approach will not work. You will have to kind of scratch your minds every time to find a new type of fraud. That is one good thing. And the other thing is, there is this one conception that every time you will get something new. Like forensic audit is not always that exciting. What happens is, sometimes you need to go to piles and piles of data. For example, thousands and thousands of emails to find that one email. It is like just finding a needle in a haystack. Right. Mm-hmm. So you need to have that patience as well when you're expecting to join forensics.
Okay.
Right. Okay. And if you are expecting to join forensics, one thing I told you is experience. If you can gain experience even a little bit in internal audit risk assessments or risk management side, if forensic is there, it is always helpful. Second, the credentials. And the third part, the right mindset, which is absolutely necessary.
Okay. So, Tushaj, great speaking to you. I think we have covered all of the questions which any student who want to get into this domain might get or might have.